12 years ago, I landed my first DevOps role. I was a single engineer handling all the security and infra operations, and what's worse, I was an absolute junior. The company, who later became a unicorn with a product embedded to this day in every page of Fox News, CNN, and other platforms, was just 10 people at the time, and we barely saw any traffic. But then, one evening, our CEO landed the first huge client, and we had 24 hours to prepare. I was way out of my depth and I knew it. I spun up a bunch of additional servers, scaled up every load balancer in the system, and froze every scale down rule across the board. Somehow, with a lot of luck and a touch of divine help, which can be the only sensible explanation, I made it work. But that night made one thing crystal clear. We needed a better way to scale our infrastructure. Today, tools like Kubernetes solve exactly this kind of challenge. But at what cost? Here's the thing, do you actually need it? Let's talk about when Kubernetes makes sense, when it's an overkill, how to know the difference, and what are the alternatives that make sense when Kubernetes doesn't. But also, when it does make sense, I'm going to show a little bit of its immense power and why this makes it the undeniable king of container orchestration. First things first, why does anyone even need a container orchestration system? It sounds like a major headache. Here's a scenario of probably most companies using SaaS production deployments before 2013. They were running a large server with their application. Getting a larger one when things get too crowded doesn't always work, so they get a couple more when the load increases, and then you need a load balancer on top, which is usually another server or a cluster of them, relaying requests and distributing them around the server using round robin or some other method configured by the admin. This allows for more stability and a framework to scale further when needed, but it's quite the manual task getting physical machines, connecting them to the cluster and configuring them to handle the load. Also, it's extremely hard to nail the size of the machine so that it's efficient with the load in a way that it's not wasteful on one hand, but won't choke on the first spike in traffic that it sees. Imagine having a central system to take care of that, a brain, if you will, to manage the cluster of servers, create more when needed, or removing them when they're not. This is Kubernetes. And while it's far from being the only option for an orchestration system, it's by far the leader in its field. Once Kubernetes provisions these servers to solve our utilization problem from earlier, it'll use pods, which are usually a single container of an application, and group them based on availability on the nodes it has. This way, it doesn't only use its resources efficiently, but can also create distribution, so that if our blue app fails because of its node that dies all of a sudden, it has redundancy in another location to serve the app from. Like we mentioned, since it's all automated, when servers are not required, they can be deprovisioned and removed. Especially on cloud platforms, this becomes a huge cost-saving factor. Need a load balancer? No problem. Kubernetes creates and integrates with every load balancer in existence, from open source through managed services by cloud providers like AWS. When a bunch of additional pods are loaded, whether due to automatic scale, and we'll see that in action in just a bit, or a user's demand, the Kubernetes scheduler will observe its current capacity, place the pods where they have space, or create a bunch of additional nodes to host the new demand. This way, instead of waiting for a new server to be physically connected or rerouted to serve the new need, we reduce the time from hours to minutes. However, production-ready solution like that can take weeks or even months, depending on the scale, complexity, and sensitivity of the applications deployed. Acquiring the skill for new hires or leveling up is not an easy feat. It takes a lot of learning. If you're interested in tasting the basics and a quick start Kubernetes workshop, I've got you covered. Check the link in the description. Before we dive in, let me tell you about today's sponsor, Twingate, the smart way to secure your remote access. You know how traditional VPNs are like having a single fortress gate? Once someone's in, they can wander anywhere. Well, Twingate flips this model on its head with zero trust security. Think of it as a modern city, where every district requires its own access path. Much safer, right? But here's what's really cool, especially for you developers out there. Twingate now seamlessly integrates with Kubernetes, so instead of bouncing between engineering and IT teams, you can configure secure access right in your YAML files. It's all part of the regular engineering flow, no context switching needed. Setup takes minutes, not days, and works across all of your devices. Plus, you get enterprise-grade security without the enterprise-grade headaches. Whether you're managing a remote team or running complex Kubernetes deployments, Twingate handles the security heavy lifting, and you can focus on what really matters, building great software. Ready to level up your remote access security? Head over to twingate.com for a free trial and see why thousands of teams trust Twingate with their secure access needs. Many incidents require an expert to dig the root cause out of a mild symptom. For example, a loopback failure of a pod can be traced back all the way to a misconfiguration in a node scaling rule that has nothing to do with the app, the pod or the deployment or the cluster itself. This can take long hours. Okay, enough with fear and scare. Let's talk about the flip side of things, real Kubernetes power. Check this out. There are a bunch of methods to run and test local Kubernetes clusters. My favorite by far is Minikube. In the past, it was considered a side project, but over the years it was adopted by the core team and it comes with a ton of features. It's super easy and effective. For this magic trick, I'm going to need a volunteer. Kidding, a metric server. This is a small add-in that you're going to find in 99% of production clusters because it helps with auto-scaling. Let's install an app. I'm not going to care too much about what it is, but for the sake of explanation, there's a deployment here, which is a scalable component Kubernetes creates to wrap around pods. And there's also a service, which you can think of as a load balancer on top of the application pod. We're going to create many replicas of this pod soon, and they're all going to be served by this one endpoint. In the pod, there's a single container from Kubernetes.io example registry that listens on HTTP port 80. Additionally, pods can be set with specific resources, requests, and limits. Requests make sure this pod gets allocated what it has requested, and limits does the same, and as the name suggests, it caps the pod so that it doesn't interfere with its neighbors. Let's deploy this code by applying it. I'll get the pods with kubectl and insert them into a nice table using Nushel's magic. More on Nushel in the video up here. Here's also the service named PHP Apache that sits on top of our application with currently only one pod. Quick tip to debug a cluster and make sure things are fine, we tunnel our way through the running service by using port forward, naming the service, the port, on our machine and the remote port it should be mapped to. So 8080 on my local host should be tunneled to the container's 80. In a split, I'll call my favorite utility for HTTP, XAge, more on XAge and other terminal API testing tools in the video up here. Here's the OK response and even the logs above are hitting an incoming request. Now for the magic powder and check out just how easy what I'm doing right now. Let's tell Kubernetes to automatically scale this application with a given threshold. To do that, I'm going to use a core component that's called the Horizontal Pod Autoscaler, or in short, the HPA. There's also a VPA in Kubernetes for vertical autoscaling up or down, but let's not complicate things too much at this point. Now pay attention, kubectl autoscale deployment, then the deployment's name PHP Apache and the flags saying the threshold for scaling up or down is 50%, and we want to go as high as 10 replicas or as low as one. Kubernetes will operate in the boundaries we gave it. It'll be quick to scale up and very soft on scaling down to prioritize stability. Cool, the rule is deployed, and just like that, we already have auto-scaling applied. Now, tell me this doesn't get you excited. The simplicity and elegance of what we just did is not something you can easily achieve anywhere else. As with any Kubernetes object, we can always get them. I'll get the HPA, and there we have it. Min, max, current, and target, which is 0 over 50, meaning there's currently zero load on the CPU, but we're about to change that. Let's create a small DDoS attack. I won't bore you with the details, and you can find all of them in the example on the official docs. But basically, this runs a busybox, which is a super light Linux container that tries to reach out to our little server every millisecond, effectively creating a denial of service attack. We can start seeing responses coming in way slower than what we actually asked the server, which is 100 times a second, meaning there's a huge load on it. Now, getting the HPA with the watch flag should slowly show an increase in measured load. And there we are, already at full capacity. The HPA scaled up, adding another replica. We can also get the pods to see they're both available now. In standard production day-to-day operation, this is how you tackle load. Note the measured CPU index is currently at 177%. Since we have more than one pod and the load is computed per core, we can see higher measurements. Our replicas are already at 4. Let's kill the load generator and wait a little. And the load dropped to 76% across 4 pods, which is not bad at all. Now, if you remember, Kubernetes is very soft on scaling down, so it has a long cooldown period and it takes a few good minutes until it decides to lose some running pods. After 2 minutes, the measured load is 0, but it'll take an entire 5 minutes until we scale back down to one replica. If you're not impressed by the power of autoscaling, let me show you another killer system that's called Helm. Helm is basically a package manager. It can run and install almost anything you like with one command, kind of like your brew install or apt get install, but for Kubernetes. Let's take Redis as a great example. Instead of finding the official container and build a deployment around it, we can just call Helm. We can get a Helm chart, that's what you call Helm packages, from a good source that has all the best practices. practices applied. And since we're after open source projects and Redis is known to have recently become a closed source, it adopts a dual source available licensing. Valky is a super popular fork, also backed by AWS, and we're going to find a chart for that. Once installed, Helm gives it a name and a bunch of other information. HelmLS gives us the status and versions, and if we get the pods, you can see there are a couple of them. Valky, primary, and one replica, which means this thing is already built to scale. Still unsure about the use of Kubernetes? While I don't want to sell something that complex, here's another extremely powerful concept of Kubernetes. RBAC stands for Role-Based Access Control, which, by its name, you can already guess, is a system for roles and permissions that can manage users across the system. From each, an administrator can control to a very low level of granularity. Who can do what? As a quick example, I'm going to create a role named Pod Reader, which is only allowed to get and list pods resources. A role binding, well, binds the role to a user we just made up named Jane. Kubectl auth can I is a funny little command that tells us whether Jane can list pods, and yes, she can. We can then get pods as Jane to see from her eyes with the response. Jane cannot list services, and trying to list them gets a forbidden answer from the API. Now, just to sprinkle some additional magic on top, Kubernetes is also unbelievably popular, so that the community and products around it are huge. One of the popular tools coming up in recent years is K9S, a terminal user interface for clusters. It can show any running resource attached to running containers, read logs, services, even the role we just created for Jane, and a list of what she can or cannot do. Lastly, it's important to say that while everything we talked about so far as resources go, are core objects coming with any Kubernetes installation, the system is built to be extended by default and encourages you to do so. Just to show the power, I'll create a fake resource with a special kind, DevOps Toolbox, or in plural, DevOps Toolboxes. Once applied, the cluster accepts the new custom resource definition, which we can start interacting with. I can kubectl get DevOps Toolboxes, but since there are none currently, let's build one and deploy it. A quick YAML with a name and a made-up spec that runs a container. Now, once the object is applied, while nothing real happens as there is no controller, which is a convention for an application that takes care of these objects, I can now get a toolbox, and there we have it. This doesn't even scratch the surface. I mean, look at this map. This is the CNCF landscape, a collection of open source or commercial products built around and for cloud-native systems, most of which are written in Go and running on Kubernetes. It's endless, like the universe, and staying on the same analogy, it's expanding rapidly and exponentially.
He told me you put 60 years of your life in them. Was it worth it?
Well, yes, but also no. Wait, I know, that's an annoying answer. Let me explain. Yes, Kubernetes deserves every little praise it gets. The open source project started at Google to manage containers has quite literally took over the world, managing the vast majority of container-based production deployments. It can manage your infrastructure, security, CI/CD, edge functions, and more. It runs on-premise, it runs in the cloud, it runs on edge locations, and if you're not sold on that, its little lightweight sibling, K3S, does it instead for thousands of Chick-fil-A stations, just as a juicy example. So that's a huge win, isn't it? Well, it's not all roses and rainbows. Having that big of a system becomes a FOMO of its own. Engineers want it in their CV. Engineering leaders think it's the wisest choice they can make because, well, their engineering peers on another company told them so. The monster feeds itself, and everyone and their system are migrating to Kubernetes without giving it two thoughts. So yes, Kubernetes is very much worth the hype. You can't fight it. It's good to know. It's good to have in your CV. And that's not me saying, it's literally part of every average job description these days. This makes it factual, whether we like it or not, but we, as a community, those of us who think ourselves as critical thinkers need to stop at least every once in a while and ask, am I choosing it for the right reasons? Is it worth the migration cost? Did we look at other alternatives and consulted an expert to make sure we're on the right path? Because as with many engineering decisions, once you go down that road, you're most likely not coming back. I hope you made up your mind whether Kubernetes is for you or not. Regardless of the answer, containers are the foundation for all the technologies mentioned above. And recently, I started transitioning from Docker as a toolkit to run local containers to a new open source option. Check all about that in the video up here. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.